think the biggest thing for me when I started out was deciding what I wanted to do. And I think that carries on throughout most artists' career. They are always looking for something new. And in the beginning for me, I was an illustrator. So some of that was chosen for me because I was assigned specific jobs. So as an illustrator, you usually are becoming the hand for someone else's ideas. And as I grew and actually left the field of illustration, it became more on me to come up with the ideas.
My first biggest hurdle was deciding to actually do that. It seemed like when you were young, like it's something you love to do, right? But how do you make a living at it? And is it valid? Like everybody else around you is becoming a lawyer, or they're going to work in a factory, or, you know, or they're farmers, or, you know, they have a thing that they do, but you want to explore this innate thing that's inside of you, and you want to make a product of some sort. You want your expression to be sold, you know? And so how do you do that? It's so nebulous.
My inspiration to become an artist was, like everybody, you know, as a child, I was an artist. All children are artists. So, but we lose that along the way. I'm a very good writer. I made my career as a writer, commercially. And, but then I also liked art. I was in college and I was trying to decide what to major in, and I'd taken an equal number of, you know, literature classes and studio and art history classes.
I think as a child, I thought I wanted to be an artist, but my parents were pretty convinced I didn't have any talent. And so after elementary school, I never took an art class again until I was in my 50s, because I just thought I appreciated art. I did crafts, but I never thought I had the talent because I couldn't draw. Now, I mean, I wasn't a naturally good draftsman, and nobody taught me how to draw. So I just assumed I couldn't do it. So other people had talent and I had a desire.
So my art style is photography, but my different perspective, I shoot off reflections of puddles, water, but mostly little puddles of water. Even go as far as to make my own puddles now when I'm traveling or out. Helps me get the shots I want. Some of them look like they're double exposures or like I'm doing a lot of post-production, but really it's just the beauty of Mother Nature and the reflections themselves. You know, I use shallow water because I want to see the surface under the water as well as what's reflecting in the water. So I use that to my advantage, and that's what I'm looking for when I'm out there taking pictures and making art.
I think inspiration finds you, actually, because I never looked for these things, and they all found me out of, you know, life occurrences, things that happen, life events. So that's what fed my creativity and got me where I am today.
My dad was an artist, so it almost seemed like a natural thing to do, but he was an illustrator and a wildlife artist, and although I started in painting, I didn't want to do the kind of work he did. So when I was in school, I wound up taking a clay pottery class my freshman year, and I flunked it. So I did fail my first class. I was overwhelmed and terrified and everything. So I went back, though. So the challenge, I think, was to go back and try it again.
So good artists borrow, great artists steal. That is an amazing comment that has to be broken down in so many different ways. If we're going to be inspired by another artist, we need to really be inspired. We need to really grab what that idea was and make it our own. The stealing in that statement is not about replication. It's about taking an idea and making it yours and moving forward with it.
I think it's totally true. You know, nobody is in a box where you don't see things, and you can't not see things. You can't help pick up ideas and influences if you're a human being, because it's all around. When I first started to exhibit, people thought I looked like a certain artist that had been around a long time. And maybe I did. Maybe, you know, I saw her work, I liked her work. Maybe I unintentionally, you know, took some of that in my work. But as I got older and painted more, no one says that anymore, you know, but I think that just happens. You see things and you internalize.
You know, I see so many artists who take characters, pop culture characters, and they put their own spin on it. And, you know, some people would think, oh, well, this is, you're really infringing on their property. But they're not just making an exact copy of it. They're putting their own artistic spin on it.
You know, I think everyone is inspired by another artist. I think that's just part of being an artist, that you aspire to be like someone in one way or another. You have to use inspiration to give you the incentive to work, I think.
When you steal ideas, a good artist will take those ideas and filter them through their hands and their head and their heart and their emotions and their joy and their pain. And when they're done with it, it will be their own.
You can borrow or steal as long as it's yours. But if you don't make it yours, it's nothing to me as an artist.
When you borrow something, you have to give it back. I think it becomes great when you can borrow it, but then some piece of it changes you. Some piece of it goes in and becomes part of you.
The idea is that when you're painting, the room is crowded. As you keep painting one by one, somebody leaves the room, and then pretty soon the room is empty. It's only you painting. And all those people who left the room are all of your teachers, all of your masters, all of the great artists of the past. When you're finally alone, then you're really painting. But they were there in the first place.